to mark his 50th birthday, Hitler's magnificent new army had marched before him. The event was staged to intimidate the world. It was true that most of the tanks were small and lightly armed, and many were driven past twice to create the impression of greater numbers, but they had served Hitler's grand design, which had been to make a chilling and spectacular assertion of Germany's reborn military might. Bovington Tank Museum, in the county of Dorset, England, is the final resting place of more than 300 tanks. The weapons which once wreaked havoc on the battlefields of the world, their tracks still and their guns silent. Even now, over 50 years after they last saw action, the hulks of these tanks still exude power and menace, providing a permanent reminder of an awesome weapon of war. In the campaigns of the early war years, Hitler's armies had struck down all before them. The German soldier became accustomed to fighting against numerical odds, and accustomed, too, to victory. The comparatively few mechanized and armored units were the only truly modern component of the German army, and were the key to much of its extraordinary success. The military of many countries were familiar with wireless, with tanks, and with warplanes, but only in Germany were these elements so effectively combined to form fully integrated fighting units with exceptional striking power. Hitler's generals had rewritten the rulebook of battle. In Poland, it took less than a month to dispose of a large but poorly equipped and disorganized army, which had fought along rigidly traditional lines. In France, Germany successfully challenged the largest and most modern army in Europe. French officers employed tactics little changed from the First World War. Like the French, the British commanders were not trained to think so fast or effectively as their German counterparts. In the ensuing blitzkrieg, or lightning war, the British forces were completely routed. Even this achievement was eclipsed by Germany's astonishing victories in the war against Stalin's Soviet Union. In June 1941, spearheaded by tank formations, German armies swept eastward in huge encirclements, and many Soviet tanks were destroyed and hundreds of thousands of Soviet troops killed or captured. For a while, it seemed that Hitler would succeed where Napoleon had failed by conquering the vast Eastern power. The tank became established as a symbol of German invincibility. In reality, The remarkable string of German successes was due less to superiority of military technology than to the excellence of German methods and training. Many of the German Panzer Division were equipped only with Panzer I and II light tanks. The turret of this Panzer I has been replaced by a fixed superstructure and used as a command vehicle. It is difficult now to imagine that such small and lightly armored tanks could spearhead the devastating operation of Blitzkrieg. The secret of their success was speed and coordination of effort. It was the new way of waging war which came as a hammer blow to Germany's opponents, forcing them to radically rethink their own military tactics. Slowly, the lessons would be learned, and eventually the answer to Blitzkrieg would be found. The fighting in the desert began with Italy's entry into the war in 1940. British forces stationed in Egypt and Sudan were confronted by much larger Italian forces on two adjoining fronts, but the British enjoyed certain advantages. This lumbering 26-ton battle tank, the Matilda, so-called because it resembled the popular cartoon duck of the period, was superior to the M11 and M13 tanks the Italians deployed. It was slow, only reaching 8 miles per hour, but was heavily armoured and impervious to all but the heaviest anti-tank weapons. It was armed with a 2-pounder ordnance quick-firing gun and a Besa machine gun. A handful had been deployed in France and had made possible the only successful counterattack. Before his removal by a short-sighted high command, Brigadier General Hobart had done much to create an effective armoured force along lines similar to that of the Germans, and in General Richard O'Connor, the British had one commander of outstanding vision and ability. On December the 9th, two squadrons of Matildas under the command of General O'Connor successfully used the element of surprise and attacked a strong Italian position at Sidi Barani without the customary opening artillery barrage. By 10 a.m., the fort was captured. Every Italian tank was knocked out, and the British had 2,000 prisoners to contend with. The Matildas were found to be capable of absorbing over 40 direct hits and continuing in action. Operation Compass followed, an astonishing 500-mile drive westwards, during which 10 Italian divisions were effectively destroyed with the capture of hundreds of tanks and guns. Casualties among O'Connor's men came to less than 2,000, whereas the Italians sustained losses of 100,000 dead or wounded and a further 130,000 taken prisoner. Had the Italians not escorted themselves to prison camps, the logistics of dealing with so many captives would have presented major difficulties. By February 1941, O'Connor was eagerly preparing to advance on Tripoli to eliminate completely Axis forces in Africa. But Churchill decided that O'Connor's battle-hardened divisions should be dispatched urgently to Greece. Within 2 months, Britain's command of the desert was to be totally reversed. On February the 14th, units of Germany's newly created Africa Corps began to land in Tripoli. These new arrivals were already seasoned warriors, and they brought with them impressive modern weaponry. They were commanded by one of Germany's most able and imaginative practitioners of tank warfare, General Erwin Rommel. The Matilda's reign as Queen of the Desert was at an end. The Matilda and the obsolete A9 cruiser tanks now had to face German machines with better armaments, better armour, and better speed and range. The British must now contend with Panzer II, III, and IV. The Panzer III weighed nearly 47,000 pounds with welded steel armor up to 2¾ inches thick. It had a top speed of 25 miles per hour and was armed with an effective 50 millimeter gun. The layout of the Panzer III was traditional, with the driving compartment at the front, the fighting compartment amidships, and the engine at the rear. The forward compartment was occupied by the driver and the radio operator, bow gunner, whilst the commander, gunner, and loader were in the turret fighting compartment. The Panzer IV, at just over 44,000 pounds, was similar in size to the Panzer III and had similar power and speed. It had originally been planned as a support weapon to the spearhead Panzer III, but the limitation of the Panzer III's 50mm main gun made the Panzer IV with a 75mm gun a vital weapon. Every German tank was fitted with wireless and had tremendous flexibility of response in a changing battle situation. The Germans were also far ahead in the technique of anti-tank warfare. The formidable dual-purpose 88mm gun was originally an anti-aircraft weapon. It was employed with equal ease against tanks, and it became the most successful anti-tank gun of the war. Rommel wasted no time. Within 10 days, he launched his first assault, and without waiting for his full force to be assembled, he moved swiftly against the inactive forward British units, throwing them back in confusion. The British were dismayed to see shells from their 2-pounder guns merely bouncing off the German armour. The follow-up was immediate, and in early April the British were forced to evacuate Benghazi. O'Connor, hastily recalled from leave, was captured. The momentum of Rommel's brilliant offensive did not falter. Within a few months, in a spectacular change of fortunes, all of O'Connor's gains were reversed, and the Africa Corps successfully laid siege to the port stronghold of Tobruk. In the late autumn, General Auchinleck organized another offensive in the desert. For a while it enjoyed a measure of success, and in December Benghazi was recaptured, but it fell again to the Germans early in 1942, and Rommel once more began to drive eastwards. Egypt itself was menaced. By this time, however, the German supply lines were uncomfortably overextended, and the number of operational tanks were depleted by such a long and arduous advance. Auchinleck decided to make a stand at El Alamein, where large salt marshes inland prevented Rommel outflanking the British to the south. Throughout July, Rommel's weakened vanguard made repeated forays against the British positions around El Alamein, but each assault was successfully beaten back. Even so, the British 8th Army remained alarmingly vulnerable. Rommel, now created Field Marshal, following the dramatic capture of Tobruk, tried to break through the El Alamein defences and planned to use captured fuel to thrust onwards to Cairo. His first priority was to consolidate and replenish his forces. Despite receiving only limited supplies and reinforcements, by the end of August, Rommel felt able to resume his offensive. The same period saw notable changes in the British command structure. General Auchinleck was replaced as Commander-in-Chief by General Alexander, whilst the forces in the field were led by General Bernard Montgomery. Montgomery, a cautious and prudent officer, had inherited a useful outline plan designed to deny the Germans the mobility essential to the success of Blitzkrieg. The British already enjoyed an increasing superiority in the air, and the 8th Army now had 700 tanks. Montgomery realized there was one vital ridge at Alam el Halfa which Rommel must try to take. Accordingly, he prepared a defense in depth. British codebreakers had deciphered the enemy signals, and German convoys from Italy were regularly destroyed in the Mediterranean. Montgomery also knew exactly when Rommel intended to strike. When it came, the Battle of Alam el Halfa was brief. A deep belt of mines impeded the initial German advance, and when the main offensive began the following morning, the 200 German and 240 Italian tanks came under punishing bombing attacks. Rommel had achieved neither surprise nor speed, and by the first week of September, the Africa Corps was back where it started. In some respects, the desert was ideal terrain for tank warfare. It was mostly flat, with few towns or natural obstructions, but a stationary tank could be easily camouflaged. For tanks on the move, however, air cover was essential. Sand blown into the air by tank tracks could be easily detected by hostile aircraft, and slow-moving machines were an easy target from the air. The column of smoke from one burning tank identified the position of the unit for miles around. For the tank crews, the everyday conditions in the desert, which they had to endure, were appalling. Insects were a perpetual torment. The heat inside the noisy, vibrating cabin was unbearable. The all-pervading sand caused engines to seize and turrets to jam. Sand penetrated the caterpillar tracks, which then ground themselves apart. The heavy, complicated machinery required continual maintenance, and without their tank, the crew were at the mercy of the unforgiving desert. In battle, the armor plating of the tanks protected the crew from rifle and machine gun fire, and to a varying extent from shell fire as well. But even the best armored tank was vulnerable to heavy and well-directed fire. For many of the tank soldiers who perished in the sands, death did not come easily. A tank sustaining a direct hit might simply explode, but if it didn't, the energy of the impact was converted into intense heat, resulting in a dramatic increase in temperature in the tank's interior. Burns and asphyxiation claimed many lives. Rivets commonly used in the construction of British tanks were an additional hazard. A hit would cause rivets to burst out, pelting the crew with red-hot metal. It was said that the screams of the dying trapped inside a blazing tank were never forgotten by those who heard them. Even when men did manage to scramble out of a blazing tank in the desert, they were frequently far from proper medical facilities, and during engagements, water for both fit and wounded was invariably in short supply. In the weeks that followed the Battle of Alam el Halfa, a steady supply of reinforcements, munitions, and supplies poured into the British camp. The Sherman M3 medium tank, known to the British as the Grant, greatly strengthened firepower with its 75mm gun. Montgomery was preparing to attack the Germans' position at El Alamein, but had resolved that men under his command would never be needlessly sacrificed. The offensive would begin on the night of October the 23rd, 1942. As the initial 1,000-gun artillery barrage began, the British and Commonwealth forces outnumbered the Germans and Italians almost 2-1 in men and tanks, and had vastly superior air power. Montgomery could rapidly make good any losses with the Royal Navy dominating the Mediterranean. Rommel could not. More critically, the Afrika Korps possessed only 1/10 of the fuel which they required for full operational mobility, and operations would soon be restricted. There had also been much disease amongst the German forces, and Rommel had himself fallen ill. On the first day of the Battle of El Alamein, Rommel was convalescing in Austria. When Montgomery's initial plan was for a major thrust in the north coupled with a feint to the south. The first 2 days were spent probing passages through the deep minefields and in what Montgomery called the crumbling process, the wearing down of the enemy's entrenched defences. The German anti-tank positions proved too resilient, and the hoped-for breakthrough into the open desert to the German rear did not succeed. The adaptable Montgomery decided on a change of tactics, and on October the 28th, he struck north towards the coast. Rommel rapidly and successfully countered. The Germans were destroying 4 machines for every 1 lost. Montgomery again changed tactics, and a third attack began on November the 2nd. It met with fierce resistance, and at the end of the day, 200 tanks were out of action, but a corridor had been forced through the German defences. The 2 armoured divisions compromising the main striking arm of the Afrika Korps had now dwindled to 2,000 men and some 35 tanks. On November the 3rd, Rommel was forced to organise a general withdrawal. Montgomery had won the Battle of El Alamein. It was now that Montgomery's instinctive caution worked against him. The follow-up was slow and hesitant. With a combination of skill and luck, Rommel's small forces eluded the vastly superior British and Commonwealth forces. On November the 8th, British and American forces began to land in northwest Africa. Rommel launched his last counterattack on March the 16th in an attempt to hold the Mareth line in Libya, but it was easily beaten off. Shortly thereafter, he was recalled to Germany. Hitler was disappointed in his field marshal, but he wanted him well out of the way before the ignominy of final capitulation. After a long succession of defeats on land, in Britain, the North African victories were received with much jubilation. In Germany, the events in this small theatre of war were far overshadowed by the Herculean struggle on the Eastern Front. The disaster of Stalingrad had left Hitler's public prestige undimmed. Indeed, Hitler's outstanding minister of propaganda, Dr. Joseph Goebbels, had seized on the occasion to stiffen the resolve of the German people, inspiring in them new frenzies of loyalty and a greater willingness to face sacrifices. The mood shared by many of the German soldiers was somber, yet confident. In March 1943, Hitler wavered, and the German army, worn down and depleted by long, bruising conflicts, desperately needed to consolidate the losses in men and equipment. For a short time, Hitler contemplated a purely defensive holding strategy on the Eastern Front, whilst Germany recovered her strength. But inaction was foreign to him, and on March the 13th, he signed the directive for Operation Citadel, a major new offensive in the East. The objective was a huge enemy salient, 120 miles wide and 80 miles deep. At the base of the salient stood the little-known Soviet city of Kursk. The fighting for Kursk would embroil Hitler's armies in the greatest tank battle in history. Hitler believed that one more powerful thrust might finish the Soviet army completely, and the defeat at Stalingrad would be avenged. On April the 15th, the attack on the huge salient was ordered, and the date was set for May the 3rd. The plan was a pincer movement, the 9th Army in the north striking down to meet the 4th Tank Army moving up from the south. They were to meet just east of Kursk itself. In the weeks that followed, Operation Citadel was repeatedly postponed. Much of the delay was caused by production difficulties with the new German tanks. It was not Hitler alone who was anxious that the new machine should be present in strength when the offensive began. In 1941, the Germans had invaded the Soviet Union with the outstanding Panzer III and Panzer IV machines as the mainstay of their armoured forces. A force of 3,350 German tanks had routed a Soviet force of 20,000 tanks. But by 1943, Hitler knew they must face an enemy which was transformed in every respect. It had been with dismay that Germans discovered in 1941 that the Soviets possessed a small number of medium tanks, clearly superior to the best that German technology could offer. In many respects, the design of the Soviets' T-34, seen here, was a masterpiece of simplicity. Far easier to build than its German counterpart, the Soviet tank could be manufactured in half the time. No less important, the T-34 was far easier to maintain and keep operational in the field. With its angled armor, it could withstand extreme punishment. The wide tracks of the T-34 allowed it to operate on soft terrain where the German tanks would founder. The T-34 was powered by a reliable 500 horsepower diesel engine, which gave a top speed of 32 miles per hour. Equipped with a 76mm rifled gun, the T-34 was equal in firepower to the Panzer IV, but had better protection, range, and cross-country capability. Germany embarked on a crash program of development and production. No one dared mention it to Hitler, but the Panther was an attempt to copy the best features of the T-34. The sloping sides increased the effective thickness of the armor without increasing weight. It copied the T-34's large road wheels to give a better cross-country ride, and the Maybach 700 horsepower petrol engine gave over twice the power of the Panzer IV. Given time for a development program, the Panther would have mastered the T-34, but it was rushed into production before reliability problems had been resolved. Its deployment at Kursk would be in insufficient numbers to make any impact upon the outcome of the battle, but would give the Soviets vital knowledge of Germany's tank technology. Germany must also master the Soviet KV-1 heavy tank, which mounted an effective 76mm gun. Although heavily armoured, the KV-1's 550 horsepower could still propel the 46-ton tank at 22 miles per hour. Germany countered with the monster Elephant or Ferdinand tank. This lumbering colossus moved at only 12 miles per hour, but carried enormous thickness of armour and mounted an unmatched 88mm gun. Remarkably, the design made no provision for a machine gun to defend against infantry, and the Soviets would soon discover that a courageous soldier could disable the Elephant with an incendiary in the air intake. The third new German tank to see action at Kursk was the Tiger tank, weighing in at a massive 125,400 pounds, and firepower came from a magnificent 88mm rifled gun. In some respects, the lessons learned from the T-34 came too late to affect the design of the Tiger, and the turret had uncompromisingly vertical sides. The weight of its armor made the Tiger comparatively underpowered. As with the Panzer III, the Tiger had a five-man crew. The driver steered through hydraulic controls, and the commander had a seat at the back of the spacious turret. The gunner had 92 rounds of 88mm ammunition. The machine gunner, who doubled as the radio operator, was located in the forward compartment. The museum's Tiger I, currently being restored, will be the only one of its kind in full working order. Throughout May and June, Hitler's generals did not waste time gained from the repeated postponements of Operation Citadel. All over Europe, German bases and garrisons were stripped to provide the forces necessary for the great attack. Despite the intensive Allied bombing offensive, Germany's home air defenses were pared down to release pilots and aircraft for the Eastern Front. Even though many divisions were below full establishment level, the final total of troops gathered was impressive. Amongst them were Germany's bravest and most experienced troops, and a large representation from the Waffen-SS was included. The morale of the German soldiers was high. Stalingrad still weighed heavily on many minds, but at Stalingrad, it had been the Italians and the Romanians who opened the way to disaster. This time, there would be no unreliable allies to worry about. Hitler had decreed that Citadel was to be a 100% German operation. Confidence was further bolstered by the great quantities of modern supplies arriving daily at the front, although the new Panther and Tiger tanks were still in disappointingly low numbers. On the airfields, the Luftwaffe was amassed in strength. The armaments, tanks, and aircraft committed to this one battle were comparable to those assembled to invade the entire Soviet Union 2 years before. Nevertheless, the magnitude of the whole undertaking unsettled Hitler, and no public announcement was made of the planned action. He said, "The thought of it makes my stomach churn, but I see no alternative." In 1941, the ragged Soviet battalions had broken and surrendered easily when Germany had first invaded the East, forcing Stalin to relax his tyranny and to rekindle national pride. The brutality of the invaders had fired a fierce determination to resist, and the myth of Nazi invincibility had been shattered at Stalingrad. Stalin had been forced to promote military officers, engineering designers, and factory managers on grounds of ability rather than political expediency. As a result, Soviet production of tanks, artillery, and aircraft had by that time outstripped that of Germany both in quality and quantity. General Zhukov, the principal Soviet commander in the field, was forewarned of Operation Citadel, and this time the Germans would find the Soviets thoroughly prepared. Throughout May and June of 1943, three deep belts of mines were laid around the salient's perimeter. On July the 1st, Hitler returned to his command post in East Prussia. There would be no more postponements. In the monumental battle about to be joined, the Soviets started with numerical advantage. Against 900,000 German troops, Zhukov fielded 1,400,000. Soviet superiority was most marked in artillery, with 20,000 guns, twice as many as the Germans. The Soviets deployed 3,000 tanks, the Germans 2,700. The Soviets had 2,400 aircraft to the Luftwaffe's 2,000. By July the 4th, the two German assault groupings in the north and the south were in full battle readiness. Ahead of the German lines, mine clearers went about their stealthy work. As the German armies inched towards the Soviet lines, the mood was one of somber expectancy. The seasoned veterans in the German ranks knew the ugliness of battle. Even in the greatest of victories, soldiers always paid a price. They had seen the dead and the maimed, and wounds which could only be relieved by a bullet from a friend's revolver. Tomorrow, it might be their turn. On July the 5th, 1943, Zhukov knew the exact time of the invasion. 03:30 hours. 10 minutes before the German columns were due to move, a deadly Soviet artillery barrage opened up. Through Through a maelstrom of explosions, the German assault groupings poured forward into action. The sky above was filled with the roar of aero engines as the German air fleets flew thousands of sorties. Bearing down from the north, von Klug's 9th Army, with the armour commanded by General Model, advanced 7 miles during the first day. In the south, von Manstein pushed 11 miles towards them. It was solid progress, but scarcely blitzkrieg. There appeared no end to the depth of Soviet minefields. As the offensive continued, the Germans encountered increasing difficulties. They were accustomed to fighting against formidable odds, but accustomed, too, to having superiority in the quality of their men, in leadership, and in machines. They found first that the performance of their new tanks was less than had been promised. Panthers were bedeviled with mechanical problems and could rarely manage more than a few miles before breaking down. Without adequate recovery vehicles and with inexperienced crews, out of 200 Panthers, only 40 remained in operation at the end of the first day. Many Stuka dive bombers had been converted to a tank-killing role, and at the outset of the battle they enjoyed considerable success. But without overall air superiority, the slow-flying Stukas proved easy prey to enemy fighters. Gradually, domination of the air passed to the Soviets. By the third day, the Germans had accounted for over 450 Soviet tanks, but the enemy still possessed abundant strength and armaments. Slowly, the pincer arms were drawing closer together. No longer were the Germans rounding up the accustomed droves of prisoners. Zhukov's field commanders were mastering the art of tactical withdrawal, of the probing counterstrike, and they would lure the Germans into ruthless tank-killing grounds. The Soviets had contrived other devices. They had developed what was called the pack front, a highly sophisticated tactical grouping for both offenses and defense. The fearsome Katyushka rockets comprised its first line, behind which were batteries of heavy artillery. When these had done their work, heavy tanks moved through to complete the devastation. The predictability of pack front assaults allowed the German defenders to work out countermeasures, but not before terrible damage had been inflicted. After a week of bitter, ferocious fighting, the German army was much weakened and Kluge was forced to withdraw some units. The southern prong of the German attack was also at a virtual standstill, and many miles still separated the two Panzer armies. Then, on July the 12th, Zhukov launched his own counteroffensive to the north of the salient around the town of Orel. The preliminary maneuvering brought one chance encounter of monumental consequence. That day, 700 German tanks of the 4th Panzer Army were driving forwards near the tiny village of Prokhorovka. Traveling in the opposite direction were 850 Soviet machines of the 5th Guards Tank Army. Neither group was aware of the presence of the other. Peering through their small viewing windows of their steel cockpits, the crews on both sides were aghast to see the strength of the enemy formations advancing upon them. The surrounding hills acted as a natural funnel for the massed armor. The two huge columns ran and broke upon each other. There ensued a battle of titanic proportions. Never before or since have so many tanks, over 1,500, been embroiled in a single battle. No strategic decision had dictated this clash, and there were no tactical plans or unified command. In the swirling dust, the tanks dueled, firing salvos at point-blank range, ramming and climbing over each other, piteously destroying or being destroyed. One observer felt that the landscape was too small for what was happening in it. Among the tank crews of the Red Army, it passed into legend as the Ride of Death. Above the field, Luftwaffe and Soviet warplanes circled and fought, but they could play no part in the terrifying battle beneath, as immense clouds of dust and dense billowing smoke obscured friend and foe alike. The battle raged unabated, and then gradually the two sides disengaged and regrouped. The Soviets left 300 tanks behind them on the battlefield. The Germans had lost a similar number. The Soviets could rapidly replace their machines, but for the Germans it was a far harder task. The main thrust of Zhukov's counteroffensive was to the north of the Kursk salient. So long as the Germans held Orel, Moscow was potentially at risk. The Germans put up stern resistance, but the troops were exhausted after days of hard fighting. Armament spares and supplies were depleted. The Red Army was able to commit fresh and well-armed troops. They had secure lines of communication and no shortage of equipment and supplies. Fighting around Kursk would continue another 20 weeks, but already by the second week of July, it was apparent that Operation Citadel could not succeed. Row upon row of Soviet fortifications remained intact, some spreading 200 miles eastward. Germans had committed nearly all of their armored strength in the east to this one great operation. Now it had failed, and Zhukov's armies were threatening to trap what remained of the German tank division. On July the 13th, Hitler formally ordered the cancellation of Operation Citadel. The Soviets had suffered slightly higher losses, but with enormous reserves of manpower and with higher levels of military production, these could soon be made good. The Germans faced graver problems. Gathering the resources to fight the Battle of Kursk had put immense strains upon the army, the Luftwaffe, and German industry. They could not afford losses on such a scale. The Soviet Union had become the anvil upon which the Nazi war machine was to be hammered. The Volga River proved to be the furthest limit of Hitler's conquest, and after Kursk, the tide of war could flow only one way, westwards. The German soldier would display astonishing resilience in defense, and German and Soviet tanks would clash many times in the 2 years of bitter fighting that lay ahead. This was the heaviest, best armed, and best protected tank of World War II, the Royal Tiger, or Tiger II, produced in 1944 and used with success at the Battle of the Bulge. Had the time and resources been available to Germany properly to develop the Panther and Tiger tanks and to exploit their full potential, Hitler might still have achieved his dream of domination of Europe and of the Soviet Empire. Today, this surviving Tiger tank is a potent reminder of the might of the Nazi regime and of the strength, ingenuity, and courage required by the free world to overcome its evil power.